today we're going to hear from two of America's best political writers, guys who know how to capture the drama of politics, and I would say in a substantially accurate way. There's my glasses. Hold on a second. But to make the formal introduction, let me introduce Stephen Landry. He's a first-year student. This says fifth-year student, but I think he's a first-year student majoring in economics and political science. He has a passion for social justice and is presently working as an intern at the Chicago Coalition for the Homeless, and was one of 20 first-year students who participated in Chicago Bound, which focuses on leadership and community service. Please welcome Stephen Landry. Stephen Landry.
Thank you, David. And thank you all for coming out tonight. A little over a year ago, an extremely divisive, frequently confrontational, and eternally frustrating presidential race came to an end. And just as we thought that things in 2012 couldn't possibly get as interesting or as partisan or as expensive as they were in 08, along come comments we thought we'd never hear from candidates, money that we thought we'd never see spent on campaigns, and political parties becoming more polarized than we'd ever thought possible. The 2012 presidential election was one of the central focuses of the inaugural quarter here at the Institute of Politics, with speakers coming in and giving a behind-the-scenes look at things like campaign fundraising, advertising, and polling. And here tonight to talk with us about the 2012 presidential election, Mark Halperin and John Heilemann, co-authors of the new book, Double Down. Both are highly renowned political journalists and best-selling authors, whose new book gives an extremely detailed view of the 2012 presidential election, focusing on the people who were directly involved with it, both publicly and behind the scenes. Mark Halperin, who's covered many presidential elections, is the editor-at-large and senior political analyst for Time. He's the creator of Time.com's The Page. He's a senior political analyst for MSNBC, and is the former political director for ABC News. He's also the author of The Undecided Voter's Guide to the Next President and the co-author of The Way to Win, Taking the White House in 2008. John Heilemann, who has covered extensively the intersection between politics and business, is the national affairs editor for New York Magazine and nymag.com, where he writes for both the Power Grid and the In Politics column, respectively. He's also a political analyst for MSNBC, a former staff writer for The New Yorker, former special correspondent and national affairs editor for Wired, and former chief Washington correspondent and media correspondent for The Economist. Halperin and Heilemann are also co-authors of the New York Times number one bestseller, Game Change, Obama and Clinton, McCain and Palin, and The Race of a Lifetime. And moderating this discussion is the IOP's Steve Edwards. So I hope you'll all join me in giving a warm welcome to Mark Halperin, John Heilemann, and Steve Edwards.
Good evening, and I want to start by apologizing for my voice. I was going for authenticity, and I thought that the best thing I could do to actually try and evoke the nature of a presidential campaign was to sound like a candidate on the last day of that campaign. So I'm going for the laryngitis sound tonight. But I got to say, first of all, welcome to the Institute of Politics, John and Mark. It's great to have both of you guys here.
Great to be here.
And congrats on this book. It's an engrossing read. How many people here by chance have had an opportunity to read it yet? Okay. So a number of you have still yet to read it. We'll be signing books in the back after tonight. But I want to begin by asking you just about the significance of the title itself, as we think about just how this election played out. What is the significance of Double Down as you see the 2012 race?
No, please.
Okay.
Please go. No.
Problem with two authors.
We're going to do this all night.
No, really.
Okay. Thank you all for coming. David Axelrod assured us that he'd built an Institute of Politics at the University of Chicago. It's nice to see he was substantially telling the truth. And we appreciate all of you coming to talk a little bit about the book and anything else you'd like. You know, the first book that we wrote together, Game Change, the title came very organically from our interviews. It would come up all the time. And after we settled on the title, it was just funny to look through the interviews and see how often people we interviewed just in the normal course of conversation would use the phrase. The same thing happened with this book. as people talked about both individual moments of import and drama in the campaign, like when Governor Romney on September 11th put out a statement criticizing the administration's reaction to the attacks in the Middle East. And then the next day, even though he'd faced a lot of criticism for putting out that statement on September 12th, he had a press conference where he doubled down and continued the criticism. So individual instances like that came up all the time. There are countless examples in the book. But in sort of a macro way, in looking at the president's strategy, both in terms of the kind of voters he thought he could appeal to, on trying to convince the country that they should double down on him for a second term, and then on the Republican side, Governor Romney, a lot of the errors that he seems to have made involved his decision. I mentioned one small example, but his basic decision to, in a number of strategic instances, to double down on a strategy that, in the end, it ended up not working, but in which he decided again to sort of stay the course, even though there were indications that perhaps switching course would have been better, he stayed the course. And as I said, in this case, it came up all the time in our interviews, either in people's analysis of what happened or explaining what happened, or in specific scenes of discussion between candidates and their staffs.
John, you guys write in this book of the Romney campaign, it was capable but insular and thoroughly tactical. What do you guys mean by that description of the Romney campaign?
I'll answer that question in a second, but first I want to say what Mark said. We're on the middle of this book tour. We just started about 10 days ago, and we've been to a lot of cities, and we like a lot of places in America, but there's really no place we like better than Chicago, and I'm not just pandering. I went to school as an undergraduate on the other school up north in Evanston, Illinois, so I'm always happy
hiss
to come.
Hiss is fine, you can hiss.
I'm always happy to come back here. We were really happy. We did an event last night at the Tribune. The Tribune did a great review of the book over the weekend. We were really thrilled about that. But it's not the best review the book has gotten. I wanted to share that with you in case you hadn't seen it. We got an incredible review from Kim Jong-un. I'm serious about this. We're like apparently the endorsed book of the Kim Jong-un Book Club, which is the only book club in the world more prestigious than the Oprah Book Club. Literally the other day I got an email that said, news alert, Washington Post, North Korea, double down, I know what it was. So I looked at it, opened it up, and the headline of the story literally was, North Korea endorses double down as proof that, quote, the U.S. is the root cause of all sorts of evils. And that's like the kind of blurb you dream of as an author. It's going straight on the back of the paperback.
And what you set out to prove in the book, too. Which
yeah, is- in some ways. The Romney campaign was, unusual, and it's a reflection kind of the candidate. You know, a lot of people, I think, perceive Governor Romney as the establishment candidate on the Republican side. And by comparison to some of his rivals, it's certainly true that he was a more establishmentarian figure. But one of the things that we write about in the book at some length is the extent to which he really was not either the candidate of the Tea Party and the grassroots and the far right, nor was he really the candidate of the establishment. And for a lot of the late part of 2011 and all the way to a shocking degree into 2012, the leading figures in the Republican establishment were looking for somebody else. As late as the Michigan primary. So in the early phases, it was, how do we get George W. Bush in, or Mitch Daniels in, or... Jeb Bush, I'm sorry. Or Mitch Daniels in, or Mike Huckabee in, or Haley Barbour in, or somebody else, right? None of them satisfied, all thinking that Romney was a flawed candidate in a variety of ways. Those people did not run. Chris Christie, they pushed really hard in all the way through to like October of 2011. And then as you said, as late as February of 2012, when Romney was having trouble fending off Rick Santorum, you have people up as far in the Republican establishment as Speaker John Boehner trying to again get either Mitch Daniels or Chris Christie or even Paul Ryan to get in the race at that late date. So Romney's neither the candidate of the establishment nor the candidate of the populist wing of the party. He's kind of the minimally acceptable alternative on both sides. And his campaign, I think, reflected that. This is not a very Washington-heavy crowd. This was a lot of these people had worked with Governor Romney when he ran, when he was in the State House in Massachusetts. A lot of them were loyalists of his from the 2008 campaign. It was a slimmed down crew compared to 2008, but it's not a Washington campaign. And squirreled away up in Boston, they were a very tight-knit group in a lot of ways, in the way the guys in the first Obama campaign were, into some degree on the second Obama campaign. Very tight-knit, very small, very insular, and not and very resistant to the criticisms that they were hearing constantly from the establishment at every turn, sometimes to their benefit and sometimes to their detriment.
Why were they so resistant to those criticisms?
Well, I think they felt like they weren't really part of that crowd, and they had a theory of the case, as David would attest. Their theory of the case throughout was this race is going to be a referendum on Barack Obama's economic management, and all of this other stuff, and this was a case articulated most clearly and forcefully by Stuart Stevens, the chief strategist, throughout was everything else is beside the point. And all of this other stuff is just carping around the edges. If we can just constantly make the case that Barack Obama has failed as an economic steward of the country, given the economic conditions in the country and the number of people who think the country's on the wrong track, he is destined to lose. And as long as we keep our eye on that ball, all the rest of this stuff is just distraction.
I want to come back and talk more about how the Obama campaign reframed that very question around the economy. But let me stay with the Republicans for just a moment. You write in the book about the way the Romney campaign felt at various moments about the rivals. And certainly I was interested to learn the degree to which of all of the rivals, there was probably no greater animus than that existed between Romney and Huntsman for all sorts of deep reasons that go back in their family's history. But what about the relationship with Chris Christie? It seems to be one where they needed each other, they were skeptical of each other, they were two very different people. How would you characterize that relationship?
You know, we try to approach these books about politicians more in a novelistic way, in the sense of we're interested in how people feel in a given situation, about relationships that people have that are complex and sometimes where there's some ambivalence. So one big relationship in the book is between Bill Clinton and President Obama, and another is between Governor Christie and Governor Romney. And you know, sometimes when we're trying to sort of piece together the narrative, we sort of wish, rather than being political reporters, we were psychiatrists, because it would give us a leg up in trying to understand exactly how they relate. Governor Christie played a much bigger role in the campaign than we realized before we started reporting the book. He had, you know, sort of enters in the drama lots of different times. He thinks about running for president. He's trying to figure out who he should endorse and has people to the governor's residence in New Jersey to sort of audition for him. Then when he does endorse Mitt Romney, that's a big moment in the campaign. Then there's this interlude we mentioned earlier where he's asked again, even after his endorsement, Romney to consider running in February. Keynote speaker at the convention, considered as Governor Romney's running mate, and then at the end with Superstorm Sandy, plays a role in the final act of the drama. Governor Christie and Governor Romney are friends now, and they got closer during the campaign, but there's all sorts of ways in which their campaign staffs didn't get along, and in which they sort of didn't get along. Governor Christie is habitually late. Mitt Romney agrees with George Bush's dictum that late is rude, and so didn't like when Governor Christie would come late. There was some events where Governor Christie was supposed to introduce Governor Romney. One was at a big fundraiser in New York. Governor Christie came so late that Governor Romney had to go on, and then he became the warm-up act, and Chris Christie finally showed up, and Governor Romney got introduced to him. There was another event, he was the marquee guest, Governor Romney wasn't there, at a fundraiser in New York, where he never showed up, just didn't show up with that explanation. And that kind of stuff Governor Romney didn't like. And then the events around Governor Christie being considered to be on the ticket was a hard thing for them personally, in the sense that Governor Romney was taking a very clear-eyed view of should this guy be on the ticket or not. And the frictions between their two camps and to some extent between the two men were pretty pronounced at that point, because Governor Christie didn't really want to be on the ticket, but he didn't want to not be asked. And so that ambivalence led to a series of kind of unusual back and forths between Trenton, as we call it in the book sometimes, and Boston, where Governor Christie was asked, as having agreed to submit to be having his background checked to perhaps be put on the ticket, then does not turn over all the documents that are requested. And Governor Romney and his team were quite frustrated at that, because they wanted to consider him, and they couldn't in good conscience do it until they got all the information. And then at the end, Governor Romney rejects Governor Christie in part because he doesn't like some of the stuff he's seen in the document, but in part because some of the materials didn't come back, and his vetting team said, you just can't go forward with him without that. So their relationship is complicated, and as I said, I think they are friends, but we all have friends who maybe we sometimes make fun of their weight, or maybe sometimes we don't like their being late, or other, you know, sort of little things like that. But in the context of a presidential campaign, those things can sometimes be blown up and can make a difference.
I don't want to leave the 2012 race, but Chris Christie obviously topped the speculation for 2016. Based on your reporting and your understanding of him and your understanding of this vice presidential vet, how do you characterize his prospects to win the nomination and what he'd have to go through?
Well, there's things that came up in the course of vetting that Mark just talked about, the things where Governor Christie was reluctant to give all the information they wanted. There was another set of things that were troubling to the Team Romney that are things that will now be pawed over extensively if he decides to run in 2016. And Governor Christie knows this, but it's a really large list of things, none of which are a smoking gun or a disqualifying thing, at least as far as we know at this point. But I will give one example, prominently featured in the book, which is that for a period of time, Governor Christie was a lobbyist. A lot of people in national politics don't know that Governor Christie was a lobbyist at one point. One of his lobbying clients was the Securities Industry Association of America. While Governor Christie was working as a lobbyist for the SIA, the Securities Industry Association was trying to get financial fraud exempted from the New Jersey State Consumer Protection Act. Now that's like a little bit troubling, but what was more troubling was the fact that the guy who was the head of the SIA at the time was Bernie Madoff.
Not the same Bernie Madoff.
Oh yes, the same Bernie Madoff. So Governor Romney's people thought, well, there might be an explanation for this, but it's kind of not a great idea if Governor Romney, who's got a lot of Wall Street ties, puts a guy on the ticket who could be characterized easily in a 30-second ad as Bernie Madoff's lobbyist. Right? That's not a great
hard,
place
hard to
be.
Imagine David Axelrod would have done that. But, yeah. Since he's not in the room, I'll say. He might have.
He fled the room to avoid that comment. He wants to cover his ears, and now he's back. Oh, there he is. Just back in time to have us make fun of you while you're in your seat rather than outside. You know, so there were a lot of things like that. He had, was investigated by the Department of Justice's Inspector General for expense account abuse when he was a state's attorney. There was a defamation lawsuit against him. His brother was involved in a securities scandal that ended up with a civil settlement with the SEC. The long list of things. If I gave you the right Google terms, you could find all this stuff in the public record, but almost no one in national politics knew about it last summer. And all of those things, as I said, there's no smoking gun there, but they will all now come under a different degree of scrutiny. Mark talked about Governor Romney's instincts about this. In this instance, they were unusually good, because people would say to him in his campaign, all this stuff's been looked at in the 2009 governor's race in New Jersey, and Governor Romney's response was, nothing's been vetted in New Jersey. If you're on the national ticket, it's a whole different thing. And you can think of things like Whitewater and Bill Clinton.
Yeah, he said, like, nobody vets, period, in gubernatorial races.
Right, yeah. I mean, it's just a different thing. And you think about Whitewater and Bill Clinton, not an issue until he ran for president. George W. Bush's DWI, not an issue until he ran for president. More close to home, Reverend Wright and Barack Obama. Their association was known in the city of Chicago for a long time. Not a big deal until he ran for president. All these things about Chris Christie will come under a harsh light. And the big question, I guess, I think, to Mark in my mind is, how does he answer them? How does he handle it? And that leads to the next larger question, which is just temperament in general. And the thing that people obviously seize on with Christie is that he is this harsh, abrasive guy, and there are incredible videos of him yelling at people. One that caught the Romney people's attention was one that really is quite astonishing, of Governor Christie in a confrontation with a constituent on a boardwalk in New Jersey. The constituent confronts him, Governor Christie answers him, the constituent starts to walk away, and Christie's not finished. He starts berating the constituent and chasing him up the boardwalk, brandishing an ice cream cone like a weapon. And it's just not, it just doesn't scream presidential, you know, to some eyes. So there are a lot of questions. You know, he's an incredibly charismatic guy. He's got a certain magic. He's got the capacity, I think, more than almost anybody else I can think of right now in the Republican Party, of fusing the establishment with the energy of the Tea Party. But there are also a lot of questions that he will have to answer, and again, answer both in substance and in tone in a way that makes him acceptable to a broad swath of Americans who are way different than most New Jerseyans.
Mark, what's your take on that very question?
Well, since we're co-authors, identical. You know, a lot is made of Governor Christie having some positions as both based on his issue policies, but also based on the politics of his state, that are a little bit out of step with the Republican Party. You know, you think about 1992, and the Democratic Party nominated someone who was pro-welfare reform, pro-right to work, pro-NAFTA, and pro-death penalty. Those were issue positions far to the right of where kind of the sense of the nominating electorate had been in the Democratic Party for a long time. I don't think Governor Christie has anything like that set of sort of heretical positions that would be in violation of the base of the Republican Party. I think the party, like the Democrats were in 1992, is extraordinarily hungry to win. They've lost now two in a row. They really want to win. I see only three people right now, today, based on their current strengths and weaknesses. I see only three people who have the establishment wing, which tends to nominate the modern era, has nominated the party's standard bearer. I see only three people who have that capacity to do that, to look like a winner by uniting, not just uniting the establishment wing and the populist wing, but also having potential appeal to Democrats and independents. Governor Christie's won, Jeb Bush has won, Paul Ryan has won. So given that the other two are significant, have taken far fewer steps to run and look like they're going to run, although they might, than Governor Christie, I think he's the most, today, the most light, he appears to be the strongest candidate. I think there's lots of questions about his temperament. His record in New Jersey is not all that good right now in terms of the economy, but we're in an uncharted territory because there is no heir apparent who is clearly going to run and looks very strong. So by default, despite his manifest potential problems, I think he's as strong as anybody right now to be the Republican nominee.
Let's come back to 2012, and we spent a lot of time, obviously, on the Republican side of the ledger with the Romney campaign. And the portrait you paint of that campaign isn't the rosiest one, but frankly, the portrait you paint inside the Obama White House in late 2010 and the first part of 2011 isn't rosy either. You paint a picture of a pretty dysfunctional place. What's going on inside the White House at this time?
Well, things got a lot better as soon as David Axelrod was left, basically. That's the simplest answer, right? Wouldn't you say? David agrees with that. He endorses that view. I think it's fair to say that the first 2 years of the Obama administration were extraordinarily productive by any metric of legislative achievement. I mean, the healthcare law in and of itself was a potential legacy making, if it's implemented correctly, and that's a whole other kettle of fish, but it's a potentially legacy making achievement. The president passed a huge stimulus law that in the view of some helped stave off the second Great Depression, re-regulated Wall Street, bailed out the auto industry. All those things were big, huge bills that passed. And yet, you know, by the end of 2010, there's this political wipeout that occurs in the midterm elections. And I think in the course of that, you know, the president's point of view by the end of 2010 was that for all of the substantive accomplishments that he had rung up, that his White House was not operating in the way that he wanted it to operate, that a lot of the things that he had been able to do as a candidate speak with a clarity of purpose, convey the big grand narrative of what he was trying to accomplish, present a theory of the case. All of those things had been kind of lost. And some of that he had various villains that he could blame. Certainly Republicans and the oppositionalism, relentless as it was a big part of his diagnosis of what was wrong. But he also pointed fingers internally and thought that there were things that his team did not do that well. And there was internal friction, and there were ways in which he wanted to both have a calmer, more orderly, and more disciplined operation than the one that had achieved a lot, but also had lost a lot of ground politically in the course of those first 2 years. And so some big changes took place, some of them voluntary and some of them involuntary, and driven very much by the president.
What explains, in your view, the disconnect or the difference between the Obama world and the campaign context of 2008 and what they were able to execute or not execute from a narrative standpoint during the first couple of years of the administration?
Well, that's a really complicated question. I'll give you three things that I think play a role, but I don't feel qualified to assign sort of percentages to them or even rank them. I think one thing is the president clearly likes to rely on a small group of people for advice and for the biggest decisions. And I think a campaign is just smaller. Even an Obama campaign is smaller than the federal government. So I think there's a lot of pressure on very few people to make a lot of decisions. It's been widely reported accurately that very few cabinet members outside the national security team are empowered the way some past administrations have done. So you got a lot of centralized power in the White House. And when you're running for election, almost everybody in that inner circle, really everybody in that inner circle, for the last couple of years leading up to the reelect, we're trying to run the federal government and play a big role in running the campaign. So I think that's one. It's just the president really likes that small group of people, but you know, I think the burden on them was pretty substantial. Two is, I think the president, you know, we report pretty clearly in the book, he really likes governing. He's in, as much as anybody I've ever covered who's run for president or been president, you think about people do it either out of ego or because they care about trying to make the world a better place. I think the president's pretty close to about 100% wanting to make the world a better place. He cares a ton about policy and substance and doing the job well, but I don't think he's as good as that, so far at least, as he is as a campaigner. He doesn't much like politics, so it's a bit of a paradox. He's very good at the thing he doesn't like, campaigning. He's not as good as the thing he really likes, which is not to say he's a failure as a president, but he's won two presidential elections, and he's having right now in particular some problems governing. So I think that's a second thing. And the third thing is the president and his team are very good when they can make it about a choice between Barack Obama, not just as a person, but the president's policies juxtaposed against the policies of the Republican Party. Now, as a president, he's got to deal with the scrutiny on him from the media, from the opposition, from citizens, of just what's he doing, not in opposition. And he was able to, in the campaign context, not have to defend his record very much, because they were able to say, here's what the president would like to do, for instance, on Medicare. Here's what Governor Romney would like to do. Here's what Governor Romney did at Bain Capital. Here's what the president has to say about that. When they're able to use their political skills, and the president's, a far superior political performer than Governor Romney, to put the focus on a choice rather than a referendum, he's stronger. But when he's got to defend his own policies and his own execution in government, it's just not as effective.
As you report in the book, this period of, 3 to 6 months, roughly late 2010 into the first part of 2011, is a period of some transitions, some shakeups, but also a period of significant introspection on the part of the president. One of the big stories that you broke in your reporting and became a bit of a dust-up at the time was this list, this yellow legal pad list that the president had written. And I want you to talk about that and also the way in which his advisors had sort of put this election in kind of stark terms to the rest of the team at a meeting at the White House sometime thereafter. How significant were these events and why?
Yeah, it's a little later. I mean, you've got this period after the midterms where we were talking about before, where there was the personnel shifts. Bill Daley comes in as chief of staff. Mayor Emanuel leaves and Robert Gibbs leaves and David comes back here. Various big changes that happen in the face of the White House. You then have, I think, a much more consequential crisis. In some ways, the midterms, for all of the ease of describing the scale of that loss, the more significant period of crisis, I think, is this period immediately in the fall of 2011, immediately following the debt ceiling imbroglio.
Yes, forgive me on the chronology.
And I think it's just where the president at that point is at his low ebb at that point in his presidency. I mean, his approval rating is down in the low 40s.
It's what they now call in the White House the good old days.
Yeah. the universal perception among Democrats and Republicans alike that he was weak, which really got to him, and he felt beleaguered by that, criticized by his allies on the left, or sensible allies on the left, obviously criticized by people on the right. The political economic situation is still not improving in any measurable way. Two-thirds of the country think the country's on the wrong track. And at that point, the Republican nomination fight has not really taken shape in all of its kind of garish comedic glory, right? So the president's team, shortly after he came back from Martha's Vineyard and his vacation that year, convened a series of political meetings in which it was time now to think about reelection and what we're going to do and how we're going to frame the case and how bad our situation is. And I think it's fair to say that the president's advisors were split between people who thought that he was maybe a 50-50 shot at reelection, a narrow, narrow, narrow favorite, and those who thought that he was an underdog. And the president's own view expressed to at least one senior advisor when asked what he thought of his standing was, I think I'm in deep shit. And that, in those series of meetings and this period in general, provoked the kind of introspection that you're talking about, which had to do to some extent with a self-assessment of how they got to that place, and also to do in a concrete way with how do we go forward, what's our messaging strategy going to be, what are we going to do on the legislative front over the next few months, but led to a deeper thing where, in the course of one conversation, the president kind of expressing the notion that he felt in some ways like he'd been hampered by the political constraints of having to deal with political reality in Washington, kind of talking about how he felt that he'd kind of been governing in some ways with his foot on the brake, and sort of saying, you know, there are things that I wish I had done, I wish I'd talked about differently, I wish I could talk about differently. And a person in this room advised him, well, maybe if you feel that way, it would be useful. Yes, it's the guy in the back over there, the bus driver, who said, you know, maybe it would be useful if you wrote these things down. And it would be a useful exercise to discuss that in more detail. So the president came back at the next of the series of meetings with this long list, pages of yellow legal pad written out in hand, where he went through a series of issues from immigration to climate change to Guantanamo Bay to poverty to gay marriage, where he discussed in some measure of, as it was described to us by pretty much everybody who was there, in kind of an extraordinarily introspective way, talked about some combination of regret over having not done more, not talked about those things, having been kind of too pragmatic and not bold enough, in some cases talking in a prospective way, I want to talk more about these things, I want to be more clear, more clarity about these things, in some ways in a programmatic way about kind of this could be part of my second term agenda, something I want to turn to then. But kind of an amazing moment for a lot of people in the room who sat there and thought, I never really imagined having a meeting like this with a president who was in this, with this degree of thoughtfulness and introspection, kind of reviewing this nearly three years of tumult at that point, and kind of taking stock, not just of where they were, but of where he was and his relationship to the state of Washington, the state of politics, and himself and his own aspirations and ideals and goals.
And part of the exercise going forward was to get him closer to that sense of himself and closer to the candidate that he was in 2008 in large measure. The other piece, though, it seems, is that there was an important turning point in how the campaign operation tried to reframe the economy question. And to do it as not a referendum on the 4 years that the president had been in office and where the economy stood, but really do it as focused on the middle class and in some respects a referendum on Romney and could he relate to the needs of people today. I want to actually ask a different question, though. This book is riddled with insights and tactics and so forth. There are political scientists who believe that no matter what happened in a campaign, that the larger structural forces were set such that the outcome would have been the same virtually no matter what else happened. Talking about demographic changes, talking about, you know, the mood of the country, those kinds of things. What's your response to that argument, that in some cases the way this campaign played out was only marginally impactful?
They're a bunch of pointy-headed intellectuals. I mean, you could look at every campaign we've covered and make the case that the winning team ran a great race and the losing team was not as good, but it didn't really matter because there's a formula about economic growth and incumbency that decides it. And you know that I don't share that view for a variety of reasons. One, because it'd be harder for us to write these books if that were true. But the other is, I think that there's those models. Rely too much on static analysis about what real politics is like, particularly because in a presidential race, unlike any other race in the country, the earned media, what happens in the news coverage, really does impact how voters see the candidates. And a great political philosopher once said that presidential campaigns are MRIs of the soul, and I think that determines who wins. My mind and my experience, as much as some of those macroeconomic things. Clearly, the environment plays a huge role in it. But there's a relationship that's got to be built by anyone who puts themselves forward to be elected. That if you cross that threshold, then you've got a chance to win. And I think that is, again, I think as big a deal as anything about demography or the economy. I think it's clear, for instance, that if the president's team mechanically hadn't done as good a job as it did in identifying and turning out voters in Ohio, it could have easily lost Ohio. And that's a mechanical thing that's more micro, but it's extremely important than some of those big sweeping issues that those pointy-headed intellectuals like to rely on.
There are fantastic insights and anecdotes and stories behind 47%, the role of the vice president, the role of and relationship of President Clinton with President Obama. I want to pick out two things, though, out of curiosity before we go to questions from the audience. One is Clint Eastwood, and the other is following the first debate and before the second debate. So let's take those one at a time. What the hell was going on with the Eastwood thing? What was that all about behind the scenes, really?
It's one of our favorite stories in the book, again demonstrating that we are nothing if not pointy-headed intellectuals. One of the things we try to do in these books is a very simple thing on some level, which is that there are these big events that happen in presidential campaigns. People watch them and are amazed by them when they occur and are very curious about them, and then the circus moves on and no one really, although people are very curious about what just happened, no one really ever answers the question. So we go back and try to figure out what just happened. And this was one of them, right, where millions of people sat there and watched Clint Eastwood get up and perform, you know, some combination of a Bob Newhart homage and Dada dinner theater, talking to an empty chair. And so we went back and tried to figure out what happened. And what happened begins with the story of a starstruck Mitt Romney, who has dinner with Clint Eastwood at Clint Eastwood's golf club in California, out in Monterey, about a month before the convention, and is sort of smitten. And, you know, it's kind of thinks, wow, this is like Clint Eastwood. He's like, you know, he looks like Clint Eastwood, he sounds like Clint Eastwood. Hey, that's Clint Eastwood. Look, that's kind of incredible. And also realizes that Republicans don't have a lot of friends in Hollywood. The president has, you know, David Axelrod and Barbara Streisand and George Clooney, you know, all equally glamorous. You know, I want to have somebody with that kind of glamour on my side. So he invites Clint Eastwood to come. And Clint Eastwood, being a Hollywood star, his attitude is, that's, yeah, I'll come, no problem. But, you know, when the Romney campaign wants to try to help him figure out what he's going to say, they had some ideas about that. Clint Eastwood's like, I got it. You know, I've got it. And you get to this point where you've got this Hollywood star arriving in Tampa. They don't know what he's going to say. They kind of, again, are trying to encourage him, but he doesn't want notes. He says, I don't want notes. I don't want a teleprompter. I don't have anything written out. And they say, well, but we've heard you give some speeches, some fundraisers. Just say that.
Yeah.
And he sort of says, uh-huh. And it turns out that, in truth, Clint Eastwood had no idea what he was going to say. And he'd been spending the whole time on the private plane flight out with a friend of his, a rich libertarian from Silicon Valley, who had brought a bunch of politically incorrect jokes that he suggested that Eastwood tell. And Eastwood's kind of laughing at those, but not really giving it, tipping his hand.
McNeely, right?
Scott McNeely.
Yeah.
And Clint Eastwood goes up to his hotel suite a couple hours before the speech, still doesn't know what he's going to say, turns on his clock radio, and hears the Neil Diamond song, I Am, I Said, which has a lyric in it which goes, I said to no one there, not even the chair. And Eastwood kind of hears that and thinks, oh, that's kind of weird, kind of funny. This guy's talking about a chair. That's, you know, what a weird, silly lyric, you know. Gets to the event, is sitting backstage watching all these testimonials to Mitt Romney. And everyone's saying how great Mitt Romney is. And Eastwood thinks, well, I don't want to be like everybody else. Everybody already knows I like Mitt Romney. I wouldn't be here if I didn't like Mitt Romney. I want to do something different. And at that point, the combination of a desire to be different and the inspiration of Neil Diamond gets him to ask somebody for a chair literally 3 minutes before he walks out on stage. Again, still with no real idea what he was going to say. They bring the chair out, they put it out there, he goes out and does his thing. Now, what's going on in Romney world is like the most abject panic you've ever heard of in your life. Governor Romney is behind the stage watching this play out and turning to his chief strategist, Stuart Stevens, and saying, is this how you guys practice this? You know, this is a little weird. And Stuart's saying, well, not really, but excuse me, I have to go to the other room and talk to someone. He goes to the next room and throws up, literally throws up. The guy who was running the convention.
He felt particularly responsible for this.
Well, he didn't feel responsible at all. He was actually not part of this, but he just thought, my God, this is a nightmare, what's about to happen. I've spent the last 3 days writing Governor Romney's big speech, which is going to happen a few minutes from now. That's now in danger of being blown completely out of the water. The rest of the Romney people are all getting blown up on their Twitter feeds and their email from reporters. They're all freaking out. The guy who was running the convention, Rush Schrieffer, runs up from the floor, wants to try to pull Romney physically off the stage,
Eastwood.
Wants to pull him off the stage. You can't obviously do that. Eastwood was supposed to speak 4 to 5 minutes, and before he went out, had been so precise as a show business person. He said, now 4 to 5 minutes, does that mean 4 to 5 minutes of talking or from me coming on and off? And they thought, well, this guy's a pro. He's like, that's, he's timing this down to the, to calibrating this really closely. The guy talked for 12 minutes. And their great fear, which they never admitted publicly, was that this would just, you know, this would be the news of the next day. Mitt Romney's most important, last controllable moment on the national stage, the most important speech of his life, would be totally overshadowed by Clint Eastwood. And indeed, the next day, the coverage from coast to coast was about Clint Eastwood. And not a single person in this room can remember a single word of Mitt Romney's speech.
It's remarkable, an incredible story. Jumping ahead to the debate cycle, they had a major rebound in momentum and enthusiasm within the campaign, and they started to see enthusiasm within their supporters following that first debate performance. You write a lot about the debate preparation, especially on the Obama campaign side, and how everybody involved felt that they just weren't getting what the president needed to accomplish across in the pre-debates or in the mock sessions, and that was continuing after the first debate. What was happening as we moved close to the second debate, and everybody knew that the stakes were higher?
Yeah. With your indulgence, I'm just going to do this briefly because I'd love to leave more time for questions, because it is a long part of the book and one of the pieces of reporting that we're most proud of, because we think it's important history, but also reveals a lot about the president, not just how he was grappling with the second debate itself, with the pressure on him, but also about his attitude towards politics and the theatricality of politics and his feelings about Governor Romney, and a rare instance, at least in our experience, of the president acknowledging that he's not sure he can do something, because Barack Obama's general mode is to say, I can do pretty much anything, and he usually does. So it was people recall the first debate was in Denver, and then there was a vice presidential debate, and then President Obama was going to be debating about 10 days later from the first debate on Long Island, and they went to do their debate practices in Williamsburg, Virginia. On a Sunday night, they were doing the second of three mock debates where they go for 90 minutes and timed answers, and John Kerry was standing in for Governor Romney, and the president performed very poorly, as bad or maybe even worse in the view of some, as he'd done in the Denver debate. And that period from that performance beginning at 9 o'clock, time to be in real time with the actual debate, from that 9 o'clock to end at 10:30 on Sunday night through the following afternoon is an extraordinary intense period for the president's advisors, who stay up, many of them, not all night, but almost all night, trying to figure out what to do the next morning. And then the conversation they have with the president the next morning, in which they talk through with him their concern, and he explains sort of his concerns and his, as I said before, lack of confidence he could do it. It's revealing about the president's attitude about a lot of things. And it's kind of extraordinary because for most of that interval between the first and second debate, Democrats across the country, bloggers and pundits and rank and file Democrats, were panicked. And the president was, and his aides were relatively confident that he would come back. That night, that Sunday night, privately, David Axelrod, David Plouffe, and other presidential advisors were quite concerned that they didn't have more, they just had one day left to try to fix it. So that scene, we start the book with a prologue that tees up that scene and then return to it in the chronology of the book. But it's, as I said, for us in reporting two books about the president, about as revealing a moment as we found, and a pretty rich one to understand a lot about how he felt about, again, a whole range of issues about himself, about politics, and about the stakes involved.
Yeah, it's fascinating. Let's take questions from the audience here and make sure we can get some microphones up.
Our only rule about Q&A, you can ask about whatever you want, just we only take true false questions.
So. All right. let's go here right on the end. Yes, ma'am.
Hi. First, thank you so much for coming. First question is, what do you think the launch of Capital Playbook today and then the New York Times announcement that they're going to do a playbook emo says about the New York media market? And second, do you think any author will write a game change as book about New York politics?
That is a very Chicago question.
I know. I think that I'll answer that question at the highest level of generality I can. It is a truism that our business is in an extraordinarily profound degree of flux right now. And Mark and I are in the magazine business, the book business, and the television business in some sense. But the magazine part of our lives has really undergone an incredible transformation not affecting us so much, but our industry over the course of our careers. And the advent of the internet and the collapse to a large extent of large pieces of the magazine business has created a lot of pain for a lot of people, but also a lot of opportunity for others. And there are new, the churn of that tumult, the churn that's been caused by that tumult is kicking up lots of new exciting things all the time. And to me, you know, these, the notion that, given the success that Politico, which was so roundly written off when it started, not that long ago, in 2007, given its level of success, that things that are in some way related to Politico, whether directly in the case of, you know, the work there of Capital New York, or indirectly in the case of others, the New York Times launching a playbook-like tip sheet, isn't surprising at all, because people are desperate to find things that work in industries there where a lot of things that used to work are not working at all. And you know, the other piece of that, the New York Times doing its data vertical again, is I think kind of an inevitable thing. They found something that worked in their Nate Silver 538 blog that drove a huge amount of traffic. It was a huge loss for them when he left, and that they would try to figure out some way to fill that hole, again, strikes me as inevitable. Again, it's part of this ravenous search for something that works in a context where an awful lot that people used to rely on is falling apart.
Would you like to answer her equally difficult to answer question about a book?
A game change book on New York politics?
Yeah. On New York politics? Well, I'll let you.
No.
If you have one. No. I don't have an answer to that question.
Okay. All right.
Let's take
we'll
other questions.
We'll get back to you.
We got a hand
we'll
all the
like
way up
Jay
in the
Carney.
Back.
We'll take the question.
Corner? Yeah. Yes, you. Yeah, we'll get a microphone over to you.
I have to apologize. I have not read the book yet. I'm looking forward to it. But is there anything in the book where you do, is there any kind of postmortem by, you know, the RNC? Why were there so many debates? Was there any thought about pushing up Super Tuesday? Maybe like the Tuesday after New Hampshire to really get some of this deadwood out of the way quickly?
No, we really, there are plenty of people write about stuff like that. Our books really focus on the candidates, they're the people closest to them, and kind of the three-part question of what challenges are people facing, how do they feel about them, and what do they do about them. So we don't really write about political process all that much in this book.
Other questions? Yeah, there's a hand up back here on the, just on the right side. Yes. And those of you with the microphones can move to the other folks where their hands up.
What do you think was ultimately more toxic to the Romney campaign, the 47% comment or the fact that he had to defend universal health care that he made available to the people of Massachusetts when he was governor?
Well, I think the first, I think, was more toxic. And when I say the 47% comment, I mean that in the broadest sense, which is to say, the only way to properly understand the 47% comment is in the context of a whole arc of things that's the terminus of a series of gaffes, a series of things that fed into the caricature and or the image or the framing, if you prefer, that the president's team wanted to put on Governor Romney, that he was a plutocrat, he was out of touch with the lives of average Americans, that he couldn't relate to real people. He contributed to that perception himself over and over again, constantly dropping gifts into the lap of David Axelrod with his serial gaffes that allowed everyone to see him as a combination of Gordon Gekko and Mr. Magoo. he made those gaffes, and that led to a highlight reel and a perception that the Obama campaign then drove mercilessly and effectively over the summer of 2012. Attacking him on Bain, attacking him on outsourcing, attacking him on his reluctance or refusal to release more of his income taxes than he'd already done. And then the 47% comment was like the coup de grace of, you know, here's the ultimate expression of coming out of my mouth on a secret video that seems to reveal that, well, I'm talking to a bunch of rich people, that seems to indicate that everything you've heard about me, everything, every gaffe that I've made and every ad that you've seen all leads to this. And it's the ultimate kind of verbal Harry Carey. That whole arc, much more damaging, I think, than the healthcare thing, in the sense that for persuadable middle-class voters who are undecided, the notion of Governor Romney is not sharing their values, not understanding their struggles, and the president is being able to portray himself, his policies, his values, and his character as being more on the side of those people, I think matter a lot more than what became a relative wash on the healthcare front because of the fact that the two candidates basically supported the same plan, which the Supreme Court judged to be constitutional. If Governor Romney had not had that healthcare plan, things might have been sort of different in a variety of ways.
There's going to hand here, and then I'll come up here, and we'll try to bounce it back from there.
Yes, I was wondering to what extent you thought that super PACs will impact the upcoming 2014 Senate and congressional elections, and then going forward to the 2016 presidential election in comparison to the 2012 presidential election. And then in addition to that, what kinds of campaign finance reform laws you would support being implemented in the future to prevent super PACs from influencing elections to the extent that they did in 2012 and may continue to in future elections?
Okay, that's less a true-false question than a doctoral dissertation, but I will still try to answer
it is the University
in the
of
allotted
Chicago.
Time. They'll play a huge role. I think it's not automatic, just as it's not automatic, that the Democratic or Republican nominee for president in 2016 will be as potent a fundraiser as the president is, or Governor Romney was. I think the super PACs aren't automatically going to play as big a role or a bigger role. Particularly on the Republican side, you've got a lot of disillusioned people who want more return on investment if they're going to give to either Crossroads or one of the holdover super PACs or to some new one. And I think that my sense is there's going to be more of an attempt to demonize giving to those organizations in a way that may combine with the first thing I said to inhibit the kind of giving we saw last time. Or people could give a ton. I don't think it's an automatic thing. In the midterms, I don't think they'll be as big as they will in 16, just simply because my sense for a lot of these rich people is they think the stakes for the White House are a big deal. My sense is that by the time we get to next year, it's going to look like the House is going to stay in the Republicans' hands, and the Senate races that will make a difference are not that many, so you're just not going to have that much money go in there. Again, I don't feel strongly about any of those things that seem like predictions, but that's my sense as a snapshot today. You know, I think that trying to keep money out of politics is a fool's errand, particularly in the wake of Citizens United and the fact that as long as John Boehner has a speaker gavel, there's going to be no legislation that overturns that. A lot of voters on this campus and in some communities care a lot about that as an issue. Most voters don't, and you can't make it a particularly strong voting issue, much to the president's frustration, and I think at least at times David's frustration. I think there should be a lot of disclosure, and I think citizens should do what they can to contribute to people who are looking for ways to have policies they support, rather than thinking that, again, particularly in the wake of Citizens United, there's some way to stop money from flowing into politics. I think there's just a huge First Amendment problems with trying to limit it, and I don't think it's such a bad thing. I think as long as there's disclosure, it's complicated to get your political message out. You're competing in a marketplace in advertising with advertising for yogurt and for bubble gum and other things. So I think more money doesn't necessarily mean there's either corruption or that there's something problematic about the way it's spent. The one thing I have a big concern about that I do listen for good ideas to try to limit it, and there's some ideas out there now, is the amount of time candidates have to spend raising money, or at least feel they have to spend raising money. I'd like to find ways to free them up from that, because I think it's a distraction from allowing them to meet with voters, develop policy ideas, rest, do other things that I think would be good, both as challengers or people running for open seats and incumbents as well.
We've got a hand up here in front, and then take one or two more questions on this side.
Thank you. In the course of writing and reporting, do you focus more on what the readers would like to know or what the readers should know? Earlier in the conversation, Mr. Halperin, you mentioned like game change and double down, take a novelistic approach. So there are, in order to reach this kind of a narrative, are any kinds of revelations or juicy details fair game, or is there a fine line when crossed could potentially compromise the central theme of serious journalism? Thank you.
I don't think either one of us feel like our job is instructional, or that we are paternalistic enough to make assumptions about what people should know. I can't speak for Mark actually about this, but I don't certainly feel like I have some monopoly on wisdom, and I don't think these books are designed to be pedagogical. You know, we're trying to tell stories that are true and that are revealing and go to the themes that we've been talking about before, which is, you know, it's an extraordinary thing running for president, and these people who do it put themselves through hell to try to get this office. And they are all complicated people who have these mixtures of narcissism and ambition and idealism, and they all could be making a lot more money doing something else. And it's always a mix, and the mix is different for different candidates. Some are more venal and some are more noble, but it's an incredible spectacle. And one of the great competitions in any country in the modern world, to see these people fighting for this position of great power and great responsibility. And what we're trying to do is to tell stories that show what it's like for them and the people who are closest to them to live that experience. And so the stories that we put in the books are stories that strike us as interesting and funny or sad or dramatic or amazing, and all of which we hope are revealing of the characters of these people in some way, or something, or in some way about the kind of the pageantry, the comedy, the tragedy, whatever it is of the narrative that we're trying to get at. But those are kind of decisions made on the basis of storytelling and what makes for a compelling story, not on the basis of what is the best fiber content or spinach-like quality of the material. You know what I mean? There's plenty of people who write about that stuff, and Mark and I obviously are like, we've spent two decades each. We care about policy, we care about governance, we care about all that stuff. We spend a lot of time writing about those things, and there should be books about all that stuff. And we don't claim that this book does everything, because if it tried to do everything, the book would be 4,000 pages long, and we'd write one about one election, it would come out 36 years from now, which would seem a little silly. But we've got our thing that we're trying to do, and the thing we're trying to do is the thing I just said.
I will say that Doris's book came out well after 36 years of what she wrote about, so it's not necessarily the worst thing in the world.
As a quick follow-up, though, the two of you together, this partnership, what's your process? How do you work your sources? How do you work together to sort of decide what's in and how it fits?
We do almost everything together, including almost all the interviews. We did over 500 interviews to the book, and we just
do them together.
Almost all 95% of the interviews we do together. The only time we don't do them together is for logistical purposes, if they're two at the same time, or one of us actually has something else to do for a day besides work on the book. We find we need a shared understanding, a shared sense of what's important, and a lot of these interviews, there's nuance in the room. To evaluate someone's memory or credibility in some cases. And so we do the interviews together, and then we rarely disagree about what is interesting, important, funny, emotional, or revealing. So in the case of both books, there was almost no instances of, you know, I said I want it in, John says I don't want it in, or vice versa. And then we just work our way through a structure, the way you have to do in a book, and figure out, you know, how it's going to flow, what gets in, what goes off the sled, and thank goodness for Dropbox and FaceTime, mm-hmm. because it allowed us to work mostly at our own homes in two different boroughs of New York City.
Let's take one last question from Anastasia.
Just to answer the obvious next question, which is, how do you get all these people to talk? David will attest that whenever we send emails to anybody we would ever want to talk to, we're not saying whether we talk to David or not, but if we did want to talk to him, all the emails start with the phrase, do you like pina coladas?
I think you'd both be ready to admit that you inhabit the Washington bubble. How do you get outside of that bubble and get a sense of how average Americans are registering these stories?
Well, as I just said, neither of us lives in Washington. When I was made the political director of ABC News in 1997, I asked my bosses if, rather than doing the job from inside the Beltway, I could live on the Upper West Side of Manhattan. I told them I wanted to be more in touch with the real lives of real people. And amazingly, they bought that. So.
I'm not saying New York's maybe any better, but we both travel a lot. I've covered politics in 49 states now. I think it is one of the highest obligations of political reporters to not just focus on horse race and personality and to try to understand the real lives of real people. It has been said by many political analysts, including Sarah Palin, that one of the problems now is the Washington, D.C. area is extraordinarily well off compared to most of the rest of the country, and that's got a distorting effect. So when we're out covering candidates, we do our best to, at events, dropping off events with candidates, to talk to voters and to try to understand the mood of the country. There are focus groups sometimes that we're able to sit in on that do that as well. But I think particularly as journalists, some journalists have become more famous and wealthier, that there's even a higher obligation to make sure that you understand just how much economic pain, for instance, right now, but also, you know, on the healthcare debate, most journalists have healthcare. And so I think there's less of an appreciation than there should be for the notion of trying to bring the United States out of being the only industrialized democracy that doesn't have universal health care. And that's something that one can say, but hearing the real lives of real people and the real stories of real people, there's no substitute for that. So not only do we not live in Washington, but I think we both fight as relentlessly as we can to not be caught up in what people in Washington and New York are thinking, and not just in Chicago and rural areas and other parts of the country. But it is a challenge, and I would say we're not perfect in that by any means, and I like when people ask us that question, which they do a fair amount, because we all have to sort of renew that vow as often as possible to make sure that in the massive amount that's written about politics and government that focuses on things that has no relevance to ordinary people, that we can't be consumed by that.
Let's close with a final question from David Axelrod.
This has got to be a setup.
How do you guys live with yourselves?
Can somebody point me to where the emergency exit is, just in case I need to get out fast?
These doors are all locked. Okay.
That's the Chicago way.
As I said, I want to ask you about two things. As I said at the outset, and I mean this, you guys, there is great drama to campaigns, and there are great characters, by definition, great characters in campaigns, and you guys have captured that now twice in your books. And you've captured, in some ways, what I know from my personal experience, that campaigns, they're gauntlets, they're odysseys in which there are all kinds of tests from start to finish. It's just some are trivial, they seem trivial, but they're all revealing. Do you believe, now having covered presidential politics the way you've covered it for as long as you've covered it, that at the end of the campaign, that people roughly have a good sense of who these candidates are, that reflects their genuine qualities? And then the second point, well, I'll answer that and then you guys don't mind waiting for an hour, do you?
I think there are people who are very attentive to presidential politics and to politics in general. We know those people, then people watch cable, whether it's Fox or MSNBC or CNN, and they're very attuned. Many of them are very partisan. Many of them have very set dispositions about what they think about things, but they're very attuned. In a presidential election year, as you know, more people are more attuned. But still, by the end of the day, there's a lot of low-information voters who really don't, at the end of the day, I'm not saying they make bad decisions or ill-informed decisions, but do they understand the true character of Barack Obama or the true character of Mitt Romney, given the amount of information or the limited information they've absorbed? I would say the answer to that is no. I think for people who are more aggressive consumers of information and have been really paying attention, I think that the campaign does bring out the true character of these. I think your MRI of the soul analogy is right, and I think you do see who these people are on display, and you can get a rough sense of it, not necessarily detailed nuanced sense that you would have a family member, but a rough sense of like what these people are all about. What I don't think you get from campaigns, and this is a question that I've been asked several times over the course of just the last few days on this book tour, is what I don't think you learn, and I once thought you learned more, was it once seemed to me that you would learn who the candidates were, and you would also see in the course of the campaign whether if they passed that, they ran that gauntlet successfully, that would demonstrate the qualities that were necessary to be a successful president. I think that less and less. and not because of any one particular president or his failings or successes, but just over the accumulation of time. I think you learn a lot about their values, you learn a lot about their aspirations. I'm not sure you learn as much or as much as I would like to learn about their capacity to actually run the government and implement their policies, their dreams, and their aspirations on behalf of the American people.
I'll give you a quick answer to that question, which is, I think ever since I've heard you say MRI, so I think a lot about that. I think it is true of the winners 100%, and it's true of half the losers.
Could you ask him what that means?
I feel like I just opened up a fortune.
Well, I'll just say Governor Romney is lost, but I've not spent a ton of time with him, but I've spent enough time with him to know that a lot of his negative traits were revealed in the context of the campaign, some with help from this area. But there are a lot of positive things about him that were not revealed.
And yeah, I would agree with that, actually. I've actually spent time with him since the election. But whose fault is that, do you think?
And how can you live with yourself?
I've gotten over that long ago.
I tend to blame the candidates for everything just because he got in the race a second time knowing his limits, where he should have known his limits. And, you know, we quote Bill Clinton in the book talking about Mitt Romney and saying he's a very nice man, but he's in the wrong line of work. He shouldn't have a job where he's called on to talk to people in public. And that's, you know, he's not good enough at doing the things that that are required to beat someone as gifted as the president. And for all the importance of consultants and fundraising and campaign ads, a lot of it is about not just the revealing the soul of the candidates, but about their political skills. And the president's political skills are just worlds above Governor Romney's.
I would say one thing about it, which is I'm not sure his campaign gave him a fair chance in that regard. Mm-hmm. And we've talked about before in some of these forums that very poignant video that would have run where Clint Eastwood did had they not had the treasure of Clint Eastwood to put on the...
But just to go micro on that question, you know, he played a role in the failure of those things to be front and center because he was uncomfortable with it.
Yes.
And you can bet that Barack Obama and Bill Clinton and George Bush all would have demanded to their staff and say, my story is not being told. The things that will connect me to people and the things that really speak to my heart aren't out there. What are we doing about that? And there's no evidence that Governor Romney did
that. And it may be that they were accommodating that part of him, but there also is a theory, as you said, and I have a high regard for those guys, and they've been here, and it's been good to trade thoughts on this.
You're a gracious winner.
But thank you. Nice of you to say. they did have this theory that if they got the nomination, they would win the election because the economy was so bad and that Obama was going to be prosecuted for that. Let me just ask you, related to that, and this is the last, these are the last 10 questions I have. You know, a lot has been said. Dan Baltz's, the premise of his book is that the election wasn't about big things, it was about small things. You guys have somewhat suggested that. You've not suggested. Okay. Well, I withdraw that piece.
Okay.
Nine
to go.
But on this issue of the economy, we had a distinctly different view in our campaign of the economy and how to, not just to talk about, but what to do about it than they did. And in that sense, it seemed to me that I always felt that the election was about some really big things, and I was just wondering how you guys processed that.
Right. I mean, I think it goes back to a comment I made earlier. I think it was about big things in the sense that the president strongly believed that the Romney-Ryan view of the federal budget, the role of the federal government, what the tax burden should be, how the tax burden should be spread out over different levels of wealth and income, I think those are all really big things, and the president was on the right side of public opinion on almost all of them, and that's a big thing, because if Governor Romney had won, there'd be much different policies being pursued. What keeps it from being about, I think, big enough things, and I think it speaks to some of the problems the president is having now, is that that allowed the president to talk about what he was against and how what he was for in a vague way contrasted with what the Republicans were for. It didn't force him to do what I think is still his biggest shortcoming as president, which is enunciate the Obama vision of the economy, the theory of the case about big things that he would do that would be popular, when the things that he did enunciate are kind of status quo and people aren't particularly happy with the status quo.
my role here forbids me from claiming rebuttal time, so I won't do it. But I want to thank you guys. I joke, but these guys have great passion and insight into this process. And the first, I think the first requirement to write a great book about an election is to have passion for the subject. And they bring this, and it's a great read from what I hear. I'm sure that you'll all enjoy it. And I think that there are books available out there for those who are interested. And there are authors here who I think have or are willing to sign that book, thus making it an incredibly valuable
Christmas
thing to own.
Holiday gift.
And yes, thank you.
For everyone on your list.
Wait, let me read. This is what you told me to say, and I forgot. Yeah. Yes, holiday gifts for everyone on your list. But anyway, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you all. Yeah.